Bangin On Wax offers the gang members an outlet for their anger. East Amy Powell has the story. Members of two of LA's most notorious gangs. Red is the color identified with the blood.
He's brought together two long-standing enemies in hopes of redirecting their anger without violence.
Gangs say they will invest the money they make from Bangin On Wax into their community.
This is an album containing the redirected energies of members of the Bloods and the Crips.
Bangin' On Wax album will be used to help build recreational facilities in Los Angeles.
Gangs have looked for new ways to redirect their energy. And as Mary Major Jack shows us, they're turning their frustrations into money.
Viewed their first video from the album Bangin' On Wax at the Troubadour in West Hollywood.
The fact the album is so positive, you know, people can't see anything negative, you know. A lot of people get killed on tape, but nobody get hurt.
All of us right here, you know what I'm saying, are trying to do something, you know what I'm saying, with our lives and with other people's lives, you know what I'm saying. Ronnie Phillips gave us a chance. He put us on wax, you know what I'm saying, to get down for all. You know what I'm saying? Now it's up to us to take it to a whole different level.
The Dangerous Records is bringing it all together from the 1994s on down to the year 2000. If we can keep this going, getting this unity going, if we can just keep all this, everybody feeling good together, you know, and not worrying about what
you're taking over. We're going to take over.
Words can't hurt you.
Why everybody out there trying to ban us from doing something? They need to put some money into what we're doing right now. Look at us together. But no, they about to get more pub on us. On banning us out of Venice Beach and John.
This is a bigger threat for the 1990s. We're coming up with nothing but hard stuff, and we're giving people a chance that don't get a chance. You know what I'm saying? That's the kind of people we deal with. Motherfuckers in the street that don't never get a chance to do nothing. That never thought they would do something. Dance Records. We're gonna do part two, part three. This is all about a money mechanism, a program for people that want to help make a change in black folks, white folks, gangs. Main folks, gangs, white gangs, Mexican gangs. This ain't just for us, it's for everybody out there. You know what I'm saying? Respect is the key for peace and harmony. You know what I'm saying? We got to come together now, because we don't, the young youth is doomed.
Bottom line is, you know what I'm saying, I'd like to thank Dangerous Records for giving us all the opportunity to do this. And realize one thing, respect is the key for peace and harmony. Bottom line.
Hey, check this out. I'm Ronnie Phillips. I'm in the house with all the Bloods and Crips, man. And this goes out to all the Bloods and Crips throughout the world. My thing is, man, brothers, to stop killing each other, man. Let's come together, make some records, just bring programs back. All these record companies to get involved with more gangs, man. Let's help the brothers, man. We got to stop the violence. I'm looking to get involved with more Crips and Bloods throughout Los Angeles, across the country. And like I said, we started with 18. We got over 300. And like I said, it's about 93, helping all the brothers in the street. This is about the gangs for 93, man. All Crips, Bloods, Hispanic gangs, white gangs. Black gangs throughout America, man. Ronnie Phillips is here to show you guys a better way if nobody else will. I'm out.
YouTube, we in the building. We back up in here. Today we're going to do one a little bit different. I'm about to start doing this thing every Thursday called Throwback Thursday. And I know the old heads can remember what Throwback Thursday used to be like when it used to come on 106 in Park. I'm going to do something real similar to that, but I'm going to do it to our genre of music. You know what I mean? To the West Coast shit, to that gangster shit that you really don't hear no more. But I figured the best way to start that off, this Throwback Thursdays, is to start it off with one of the most iconic albums to come out of the West Coast that influenced the world as we know it and still does to this day. And it's hella underrated. You know, I don't think it gets as much credit as it should. Nobody can argue the fact that this album has hella impact on not only the Bloods, but the Crips. It's called Bangin' On Wax. And it's the first of its kind. It came out in 1993. And the album was commissioned and put together by a man named Ronnie Phillips. Now, Ronnie Phillips owned a record label called Dangerous Records.
In the room, and they don't know what's going on, it's hard until you sit down and talk to them like men, and they can understand what it's all about. And I think the whole thing was respect. I think if you give respect, they'll give you respect.
We're trying to show them that we can come together, make a record, and show positive issues, and at the same time, prove that we have talents,
right,
other than just pulling triggers and doing whatever, selling drugs.
Producer Ronnie Phillips says he wanted to give the gang members an opportunity to do something positive.
I mean, I don't look at them as being Bloods or Crips. I look at them as being my brother. Once we understood that, yeah, we started a relationship. And once you start a relationship, then you can work together. Then you become business partners. Then you can grow, become producers, actors, whatever. Because there's a lot of talent in the streets, and people overlook that.
And he commissioned Tweety Birdloak and another rapper, Red Rum, I believe it was. It was Tweety Bird and Red Rum, if my memory serves me correctly.
Red Rum is out, 5,000 G. Kelly Park started in 85 and ended in 93.
So he was responsible for bringing in the Bloods, bringing in more Bloods, and we were already big Crippin' on we were already Crips, of course, but we were all Tweety Bird Loc album Underworld Connection
to find talent, you know what I mean, amongst their communities. Now Tweety Bird Loc and Red Rum, they went out and they found a lot of these rappers today that, I mean, you know, I think Sin could have been from NWA. You've got a Big Y, Red Rum was a rapper himself, Bloody Mary, AWOL. You know, a lot of these rappers, though, they ultimately end up getting killed at some point. You know, I mean, they wasn't just rapping their lyrics. You feel me? They was living the life. And that's what Bangin' on Wax really, you know, when it came out, made it so different from all the other albums, is that you have both the Bloods and the Crips, who are real street gang members, come together to get the money in order to give, you know what I mean, in order to rap on the tracks.
Blueprint for gangs across the world in the 90s and early 2000s. One of my friends lives in North Carolina, and he said the gang that started in his neighborhood, they basically copied everything they heard on this album, from the slang to the way you guys dressed. At that time, did you think that this would be one of the most, if not the most iconic gangster rap album in history?
Be honest with you, I had no clue. And then they kept it from us. The record company kept it from us. They didn't really want us to know how well this project was doing. So I had no clue how well it was doing, other than the interviews, when we go to the interviews and stuff, over the phone interviews and stuff like that. And the videos, the music videos, on Video Jukebox, when they were like just being requested.
First of its kind, because before that, ultimately, there hadn't been a lot of like gangbanging wasn't prominently on music, like mainstream music. You didn't hear a lot of people giving it up for their hoods or so forth. I mean, you have groups like NOTS, you know, that had Kiki Loco and all them that was for the Crips, and then you had DJ Quick and, you know, some other people who, you know, with shot out Bloods and so forth. But I mean, like, Bangin' on Wax was really a first for it. And for it to drop at the time that it did in 1993, you know what I mean? Personally, I believe it promoted more gangbanging, and its offspring brought more gangbanging from it being out. You know, the mission was, right? If you listen to Ronnie Phillips, he'll say that, you know, it's for them to come together and be a unity. But I feel like this album did the furthest thing from that. And keep in mind, it's not only one Bangin' on Wax 2 and Nationwide Rip Riders 1 and 2, Damu Riders 1 and 2, the greatest hits. You had a gang of albums. But now at 41, I sit back and I wonder, you know, knowing what I know and, you know, coming off that Ice Cube video, you know, I wonder, was Ronnie Phillips really working in partnership with some of those CIA operatives and big wig people that came together to ultimately push gangster rap? Because, you know, yeah, Bangin' on Wax is one of the most monumental gangster rap albums ever, and it still influences people and kids to this day. And you gotta think, for me, when this dropped in 1993, I would have been 11 years old, but I can still remember the impact of it being around me. I remember when you had to buy this type of stuff, they had the CDs in these big plastic things so you couldn't steal them. And a lot of times they were explicit records. You know, you had to have an ID at the checkout station, or sometimes even like with the Dr. Dre's album, they'd have that album behind the counter. You know, you couldn't just readily, because, you know, parental advisory and all that stuff was, you know, still coming off that, you know, time of being censored and making a big deal about people cussing on the word. So that's how old I am. You know, I'm an old school cat. And, you know, I remember in my neighborhood, in my community, Bangin' on Wax and hearing all that stuff, being at hood parties when I was young and all kinds of stuff, and hearing gang members listen to gangster shit like this, though. You feel me? So what we gonna do on this one, we gonna go through here. We ain't gonna listen to the whole song, but you know, I'm gonna vibe out with y'all. We're gonna go down memory lane. We're gonna let the albums play, Bangin' On Wax 1 and 2, and we're gonna come to a conclusion at the end of this video right here. You know what I mean? Who came the hardest? Was it the Bloods or was it the Crips? You know what I mean? And we're gonna base it off of the whole thing. And one thing I forgot about this album right here is that this album is produced by DJ Battlecat. Yes, the notorious DJ Battlecat, the one that's done did all the beats for Snoop, the Eastsiders. He's a West Coast legend. He's been in the game for a long time. He's the production behind a lot of these beats we're going to hear on this first Bangin' On Wax.
So the Bloods is on one side, the Crips is on one side. We're looking at each other. Some of us know each other. Some of us don't. Some of us want to communicate. Some of us don't, because it's like, I don't know what to get from this shit, you know? I don't know if we're going to, you know, get down on site or just gonna go smooth. So Tweety Bird and Red Rum came together to introduce both hoods and person behind the from their hood. Mm-hmm. So that went well. With them being funny, a bagging session started. Mm-hmm. And it went cool, and then it went to its level where they couldn't handle it. Mm-hmm. Well, maybe one of the Crips was more dominant and more mm-hmm. funny and was hardcore about, mm-hmm. you know, his, you know, bagging.
Yeah.
And so next thing you know, one want to be physical. Mm-hmm. Okay, well now two different bloodhoods that not it's not known to get along side up together to say, hey, fuck that, you know. Mm-hmm. What's up, blood? You know, tell your boy to hush. He's saying too much. You know, mm-hmm. he can't handle it. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, one is standing firm like, fuck that shit. You know, I'm me. My nigga, I don't know you. This our first day. What you mean, nigga? This Crip. Mm-hmm. You know, you know, be with this shit. If you either you with it or get the fuck out the, you know, out mm-hmm. the way. Don't join the circle. Cause mm-hmm. that's what we do. This shit's fun. But you want to take it serious, we can. So, next thing you know, Coach start opening up and motherfuckers was grabbing their pistols. Then we had the great legendary Leon Haywood and Ronnie Phillips, rest in peace, who was the executive producer of it. They came out.
That's Dangerous, right?
Yeah, we talk. Yeah, Dangerous Records. Yeah. So, and then we seen some old cats in their 50s. Mm-hmm. They sitting like behind all of us on both sides in corners, mm-hmm. you know, and then they stood up. Because Leon Haywood had to protect his property and bring everything back to a medium, like, hey, hold up. We know it can get like this, but respect what this is. Mm-hmm. This is a chance for you guys to be something other than what you are. Mm-hmm. I'm with the shit, but we gonna respect what's happening right here. Mm-hmm. And they respect him because he said some other things that was encouraging, like, you see what Death Row's doing and mm-hmm. drain them, they moving, they mm-hmm. starting. Now y'all need to come to a happy medium so y'all can potentially get where they're going mm-hmm. if y'all want to do this music shit. Mm-hmm. So that helped tremendously. Mm-hmm. Now let's go back to your question.
With the first track we're going to get into it, it's just more of like a skit. I ain't going to play the whole thing. It's called Gangsta Talk. And it's just a bunch of these cats in there talking and so forth. But let's give it a quick little listen. Now, me personally, I think this album right here caused more gangbanging than anything. I mean, it may have brought unity together. It may have made Ronnie Phillips a gang of money. You know what I mean? I don't know if the other artists ever made a lot of money. I've heard and read stuff online that Ronnie Phillips actually, you know, took a lot of money from people and didn't pay him. I don't know how true that is. But, you know, listening to the skit, you feel me? You know, I get it. I understand it. You feel me? But the narrative, right? The narrative of the gangster shit. This is what we're talking about. The narrative of the gangster shit is going to get pushed on this shit. This ain't, you know, every song on here is talking about killing an op or something of that sense. And of course, it's done lyrically, but this album, I guarantee you, and the lyrics in it promoted a gang of blooding and cripping and murders. No telling how many bodies or people who've been killed behind, you know what I mean, filling their head with this gangster shit. But this is Hollywood. This is a Hollywood album. This was produced, you know what I mean? It was mastered. It was crafted. The videos were put together in Hollywood. Ready, set, action type of shit, yeah.
This is most notorious gangs, the Bloods and the Crips, meet for the cameras. On the mean streets, home to gang banging, they've turned bullets into a war of words, a rap record recorded by 16 members of the two rival gangs.
This is Hollywood. Who makes the money off all the bodies that fall off here? The cat that's catching the body, believe me, he's not getting paid for that. He's helping the private prisons continue keeping their wheels going. He's helping all these people that got shares in them stocks keep going. But who gets the money? Who really benefits from all this though at the end of the day? But that's enough of the intro. Now we're going to get into the second song. And the second song is called Bangin' On Wax Itself. And it's a Battle Cat track. The beat is produced by DJ Battle Cat. And the first rapper on this track is Domino. He goes by a different name on he go by Genuine Draft on his Bangin' On Wax days, but the world probably know him better as Domino, and he had that ghetto jam back in the day. He the first rapper on here, and this track right here is unlike the majority of the songs on here because this track got the Bloods and the Crips on it, and they going back and forth on each verse right here. So we're going to go ahead and give that a quick listen and then keep it moving. Now that beat right there samples a classic Zappin' Rogers, More Bounce to the Ounce, and that sample has been copied a million and one times across the board in West Coast hip hop right there. You think about when this dropped in 1993, like this was the highlight, this was the high level of West Coast gangster rap right here. So this is the sound of the streets right here. This right here just brings back that feeling. This is that funky West Coast beat that all West Coast shit used to sound like right here. This song right here is hard though. They got the Bloods and the Crips, and I have to say they both held their own on this track right here. You know what I mean? I can't say one side better than the next side, but this song ends, and I believe this song got a video for it too. If I remember, being on the box and all that back in the day. But this song, when it ends, it goes into the Blood side now. So now the album is gonna go a few songs from the Bloods, like 4 or 5, and then it's gonna go 4 or 5 from the Crips, and then they got like one song at the end where they both on the same track together. So let's go ahead and jump into the Blood side and see what we think about that.
Just love it when I eat, bring it falls. Full, just the life of a big dog. Down the crab, like a bottle of CB. Ain't what gangsta.
Hey, as soon as that, you hear that little noise, and then that beat drop, that beat is hard as hell right there. That's a hard ass beat right there. I give it up to the Blood side on this one right here. Blood's got this one. This one right here. This is one of the ones I ain't skipping. But let's see if they can keep that consistency when we get into the next track and see what the next one like. Yeah, nah, this give me like that old original hip hop type of feel, you know what I mean? And it's like, I don't know, coming off that other song and how hard that song was, this one right here, yeah, this one getting skipped. I can't mess with it. Hey, that beat right there, hey, that beat is hard as hell, especially when they stop rapping and they go to the chorus and it just lets that little that shit right there. Hey, this shit hard right here. Hey, and it, I don't want to play the whole song. I already know I'm going to get copyrighted and everything like this, but hey, there's the third verse on this right here. This third verse on this one, man. Hey, bro, it comes on here hard as hell. So I give it up so far, the Blood side, 2 points on the board right here. This was Rip a Crab in Half, and we're going to get into the next one. Okay. It's the one right here. Not a Freddy Krueger. Hey, I don't care if he was a Blood, I don't care if he was a Crip, you gonna bump that Pyro Love. As soon as that shit come on right there, hey, for me, for the longest, I didn't even know that was Bloody Mary, that was a female that was spitting that. I always thought that was a dude, but it was a female. She later was signed to Death Row Records and ended up getting killed in Compton on a motorcycle. Y'all can look her up, though, Bloody Mary. But, you know, she got one of the hardest hood roll calls in that verse right there, and I don't give a damn when this... Back in the day, this is all you would hear right here. This was an anthem right here. And to me, it still is. Anytime I hear this shit come on right here, it puts me in that zone right there. It takes me back to them days, though, because this was another era right here. This is an era. This is a part of time lost. Like, a lot of cats ain't going to feel me on this because, I mean, there's only a few of us out here left living and breathing. But, hey, Pyro Love, this shit right here, classic. Y'all tell me what y'all think. And there's another remix to this, the radio edit that got another verse on it where they was eating it on that shit right there. So, yeah, hey, classic on this one right here. Again, for me, this is too slow, though. You come off one good one, and then you go into one bad one. So, Blood side, y'all 2-2 right now. Two good ones, two ones I got to skip. Spots and a whole nine. And if you catch me, I'll be hoping to crawl down. So a big bag. See, this shit still feel like too much of that early 90 rap right there. You feel me? Like, I get it. That's when it came out to me. But shit, me, I be liking this shit that got that funk, that shit that move you type of beat. You feel me? Like, this shit right here, shit too slow for me. Too slow for me. It's another one. Skip. So now we had three skips for the Reds, two hits for the Reds, and we about to, I feel like there's either one more Blood song and then go into the Crip side, or we're going right into the Crip side. Let's see. Yeah, this one's cool. I could fuck with it. I like that smooth little soul beat that's right there. That thing cool. I could fuck with it. And they spitting on there. I mean, they getting off. The first cat that got off, I believe, is a Big Y, right? From little, they used to be from the Young Soldiers. And if y'all know about the Young Soldiers, they was on the Murder Was the Case soundtrack with that East Side, West Side. But Big Y, you know, he's just passed not that long ago. He's an original. And a reputable at that, with no smut on his name. And he'd been rapping for a long time, but you know, he was the first one that got off on there. And then the second one, they cool. But I feel like this is the end of the Blood side right here. So far for the Bloods on Bangin' On Wax, we're gonna give them what they got. They got two ones that was hella hard, and then we got one that's all right and three skips. So let's see if the Crips got the redeeming, if they go harder, or if they're gonna keep it where the Bloods is at. Let's see. Yeah, it's a cool little intro for the Crips right here. Got that real like West Coast feel to it. The motherfucker rapping, he ain't too lyrical, but you know what I mean? He could stay with the beat, and he talking on some West Coast, some gangster shit. You know, it's a cool little smooth little intro and shit. It don't stand out to me though, but it's cool. I give it a, you know, lukewarm, okay-ish, you know what I mean? That's what I get out of it. Yeah, that's a negative for me on that one right there. That's just not a, you know, the intro funny and shit. And you gotta think about gangbanging, right? The young cats in 93, they was coming off of the Reaganomics. So they watched their neighborhoods crumble. You feel me? The mother, father, household dynamic. This is the time when all that is getting, you know, continuously broken apart. And for young cats to listen to that shit, you know, that's how young cats was out there though, rebellious. I mean, in a sense, similar to what today is, but yeah, the song is a negative for me though. It really don't give me, nothing stands out to me about it, the cat rapping. So this is an L on the Crip side right here. So we got one lukewarm and one L so far on the C side. I give that one to the Crips right there. That's the first song so far on the Crip side that I'll be like, hell yeah, got that, you know, the way they crit, 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 that shit right there. I like how that shit ride into that that funk beat right there. You know what I mean? That shit cool right there. I like that shit. And the first cat rapping, once again, that's Domino. And Domino, I always been a fan of. He got a nice smooth flow, and that's, he from Rolling 20s. That's why you hear him giving out to the Doves at the end of that song right there. He was from Rolling 20s though. And so far though, we got 1-1-1 across the board for the Crips. One lukewarm, one L, and now they got one point on the board for that Crip. Yeah, I like this shit. This shit cool right here. You feel me? This shit got that smooth ass motherfucking beat right there. Motherfucking make me feel like some Scarface type of shit right there, the way old boy was rapping and shit right there. I like that shit. And it's, you know what I mean? For the Crips side right there, I'll give them that one as a lukewarm. So they got two lukewarms, one L and one good one so far right there. So y'all, that shit's cool right there. That shit, it's all right. Yeah, they got another one with that one right there. I like that shit. And that was actually the first single from the Crips side that had a video to it in the whole nine to it. That one was called Steady Dipping right there. And the next verse got Domino on there and he go in, but I don't want to get this video too long because I know going over both albums and shit already going to be long as it is. So keep it short. But yeah, we're going to give it up to the Crips side on that side right there. So far we got two, one lukewarm and one L, and we're going into the next Crips song right here. I feel like this one right here, probably my favorite on the Crips side right here. That shit is, hey, I think the whole concept of that song is hard because Crips, unlike the Bloods on this one right here, they was coming with I got the trash truck back there. They was coming with a different concept. They was just going straight gang bang hard on the record. They came smooth on some player shit right there, macking to some slob bitches right there. That's what they talking about, pulling your bitch. You know, even though she on the enemy team, I'm gonna mack that bitch, fuck that bitch, and have my way with her. You know what I mean? Shit, we win type of shit. This always was my favorite on the album though. Macking it smooth as that. Feel like some could have been some Dre shit. You feel me? So I fuck with this one. Yeah, they got another point on the board for me. Hey, they get another point on the board right there. They keeping that shit going right there. That shit track the pack. I mean, it ain't hella hard, but some motherfucker can fuck with it though. You know what I mean? Ain't no shit I just gotta skip. So Crips is in the lead right now. Crips is in the lead.
Of the universe and civilization. So the gangbanging mind has a philosophy of its own that needs to be manifested. color. So preservation of the black race depends on us. So stop the bullshit. Peace out from Brother Dao Wu.
He was trying to kick some knowledge. But you think anybody pay heed to that shit right there? Or you think they just heard all the gangster shit before that? What y'all think? So, this is where the album end right there. So the Crip side, gotta get to the Crip side. I mean, the Blood side got that Pyru Love, and that's a classic right there. But you know what I mean? Y'all tell me below in the comments, who y'all think took that first album on Bangin' On Wax? The C side or the B side? Now we're gonna get into the second Bangin' On Wax, and this came out a little bit after, not a whole lot, but a little bit after the first Bangin' On Wax. And it's got a gang of classics on here. Me personally, I mean, I like Bangin' On Wax 2 a little bit more than I do Bangin' On Wax 1. But the Bangin' On Wax 2 album kind of follows the same manuscript as the first Bangin' On Wax. The first song, again, is Ronnie Phillips with the Bloods and Crips. And they got some dialogue and they going back about the album and all that. This time I'm going to skip all that. And it's a long ass one on this one right here. But if y'all want to hear that, y'all can go listen to it. You know, it's on YouTube, whatever, wherever you listen to music. I'm sure they got it. But then the second song, again, is like the Bloods and Crips on the same song. And they going back to back. And it's called G's and Lokes, if I remember correctly. Yeah, that one right there, they both hold their own on that one. Again, true to the original. And quick little story, I remember when this came out, I had got this on tape. I got this on tape at first, and I got it from Easy Mart on Colfax. My homeboy's mom had to buy it. I was like 13 or 14, but me and him both got it. He had got the CD, and I got the tape. And I remember when this came out, though, we was hella young. Y'all from Denver, y'all know when Easy Mart used to have the CDs and the audio in the backpack on Colfax way back in the gap. Now it's like a dental place and shit. Crazy how times can change. But that's the last song of the Bloods and Crips on the same track. Now we finna ride into the first song on the B side. Cool. It's a cool little start to the B side right there. The cat that first came rapping and shit, he hard though. I like him. He saved it for me because at first I heard it, but when he got on the track, yeah, I could give it a little bit of you know what I mean? So we're gonna get this, you know what I mean? And we're gonna jump into the next one. Hey, this beat right here, I ain't gonna lie, that motherfucker is vibey as fuck right there. I fuck with that beat heavy right there. That shit is hard. First cat that came on here, he was cool, but now I gotta let this one play a little bit more because I remember the next cat that come on here, man, he float on this motherfucker right here. Let's keep it moving. Now when I be crap, my creep real slow. If they rollin', I figure I'm
most times they shut. Smoke like a blunt, all over gonorrhea. My 21 shot Glock 9mm already cut. I lost baby, it's me.
Yeah, that one right there, go though. I like that shit right there. I fuck with it. So that's a point on the board for him right there. That shit probably the hardest B-side song on this album right here to me. I fuck with that one heavy right there. That Mafia Lanes right there. That shit that right there just encapsulates all of that 90s era, gangbang era. Like that shit just got that feel to it, you know what I mean? And motherfucking the production, the motherfucking rap on there, the motherfuckers came hard on this little shit right here. So big points on the board for the B-side right now. And then this next song, though, got a hard-ass beat, too, if I remember correctly. Let's go ahead and jump into it. Yeah, that's another banger right there for the B-side. The B-side got a banger with that one right there. Can't stop, won't stop. That shit's hard. I don't know. Motherfucker can't argue that one with me right there. I know them motherfuckers is getting off on that side. That shit hard. That beat is hard, that little sample in the chorus, that that shit right there, that shit made that motherfucking beat right there. Other than that though, the motherfucker wasn't really rapping hella harder than that shit. I feel like the cats in the second and third verse, they go off a little harder, but that one we gonna give it, you know, it's a lukewarm track right there. But so far, B-side is pretty strong so far on this Bangin' On Wax 2. We gonna give it to the B-side so far, eh? This shit is cool. So this is the beginning of the Crip side right there, and that shit's too outdated for your boy. I can't fuck with it. I can't get jiggy with it, you dig? I can't fuck with that part right there. We gotta skip that one, so that's down for the seats, all right? See? Saw Red Rye, yeah, that shit go right there, and that's an anthem. Hey, when I hear that shit, all I can see back in my head is the old days of those big blue laces and motherfucking, you know, back then people used to wear BKs and all kinds of shoes and shit like that. And this was a Crip anthem right here. This shit, I used to hear this shit all the time. So yeah, Crips is on the board with this one. They didn't put the first point on the board with the East Side Rip Ride right there.
Let's go ahead and jump to the next one. Yeah, I like this shit. This shit got that like Warren G, G-Funk, West Coast feel to it and shit like that. It got that, y'all fuck with it. So this is another point for the Crips right here. But it's crazy, you know, you think about this album, think about Bangin' On Wax 1 and 2 and how many people, you know, would hear this shit and live and die by it, or would try to be like a Crip, would try to be like a Blood after listening to this shit right here. You know what I mean? And this is like a manuscript of gangbanging, right? This right here, you listen to it, live it and breathe it, you know what I mean? Next thing you know, your life doesn't even exist no more. You feel me? Can't come back from that. Ain't no reset, ain't no continue. This ain't no video game. You lose your life in this life, it's gone, man. This shit all right. I mean, I could fuck with it, but it's dated for me. It's like, it feel like some hardcore gangbang shit, like some shit you want to go out and ride to on this one right here. So I get this one. This one's like one of them lukewarms right there. They kind of, right now, I say the Crips got a couple, what they got, two on the board, two lukewarms and one skip so far, right? So far, kind of even with the B-side, but the B-side kind of up on them right now, I say, with the overall. But let's keep it moving to some of the last tracks. Crips, I got a point with that one for sure. Every dog got to today right there. That shit reminds me of my big bro that done passed, Gabe Velasquez. He was from Fortray, and hey, that was his shit right there. He always be on this shit, and he had that shit hit up. That shit was back in the day. God bless his soul. But yeah, Crips, I, yeah, that's one of them right there for sure. I got that bass line from that, looking for that good stuff, looking for that, that shit right there. I like that beat. I fuck with that beat. That beat's cold, but motherfucker rapping on that, I think that's Six Pack, right? That shit cool right there, but I get a song like this is like a lukewarm track to me. You feel me? That's what I get this one right here. So, you know, now we about to go into one of the last songs. I feel like there's one last song. It's called We Wish We Were Here. It's Bloods and Crips. It's like a memorial song for their homies and shit, but let's see if I'm right or if I'm wrong.
Pour out some liquor for the niggas who ain't here. I miss all my homies and every day I hold back tears. From June up to Tim, VD Legend, Lil Black, Jack Daniel, Lil Scatterbrain, T Money, Lil B and T Black. You know you got love from the carriage you ran with. We wish you was here, but I just can't understand. Can't go to my niggas like a permanent in your sleep. I never forget you, cause Kelly got one.
Yeah, I fuck with this one right here. It's like a memorial song for all the motherfuckers that ain't here no more right here. And this was one of the singles they put out right here. And this was the last song on this album right here. So, you know, for me personally, I think one of the best Crip songs is on the Greatest Hits album. It's called Everything Gonna See Alright. With the remix, it's Domino, what's his name again? Genuine Draft. And that's one of the hardest Crip songs. But, you know, going between both of these albums right here, you know, I have to say the hardest side, the winner of side one, I would have gave to probably to the Crip side, me personally. On this one right here, I probably would have gave it to the Blood side. I think the Bloods came harder on this one. So 1-1, I think that's an even win right there. You know what I mean? But both albums are legendary albums and shit. And I figured, you know, I'd get on here real quick and make a quick little review about it, because I ain't seen nobody making a video about who came the hardest. And I know it's very debatable. So, you know, y'all tell me down there in them comments below who y'all think came the hardest between both of these albums right here. Y'all let me know. You know, let's see if my motherfucking, if my ear be on point. Y'all tell me. But yeah, these are classic albums. They done did a lot for hip hop, good and bad, however you want to look at it. But, you know, till the next video, I'm gone.